Present. We will get started here. I want to give people a little extra time to get over the main show. Before I go on any farther, you'll notice that there's a little green thing there on each seat. We'd like for you to fill those out as nearly as you can and return them either to this table up front or the table out back where the copies of Ozark Folk Songs are. I'm going to talk just a little bit, but mostly what we're going to have is some fun singing this afternoon for about an hour and a half, and I'll talk as little as possible. There are a few things, though, that I want to say before we get on into the singing. First of all, since this is basically a program to announce make an official announcement of the reprinting of Ozark Folk Songs, it perhaps would be a good idea for me to briefly talk about the Ozarks and also to talk about folklore and folk songs. And so, to do that, we'll begin with the Ozarks. And that's very easy to talk about because nobody knows exactly where the Ozarks are. It's a very well-known mountain region, but if you ask any two authorities on the Ozarks exactly where the region is, you're likely to get two different answers. Having said that, I'll proceed to show you where they are, at least my interpretation of where the Ozarks are. Basically, the Ozark Mountains is an extremely old mountain range that lies parts of five states, part of Illinois, Missouri, Arkansas, Oklahoma, and Kansas. And more or less, the boundaries are on the west, the Neosho River, on the north, the Missouri River, on the south, the Arkansas River, and on the east, the Mississippi River. So, having said that nobody knows exactly, or at least no two people agree exactly where the Ozarks are, although they have a rough idea, and this would be pretty much the way I think most people would probably include most of this area in their definition. The second question is, where did the name come from, the Ozarks? And again, I have to confess that no one really knows. There are several explanations, several theories about where the Ozarks got the name. And just for the sake of the record, I'll throw out a couple of these. You may accept them or reject them as you please. They're probably as good as any other current explanation of where the term came from, so you can take it for what it's worth. The first theory is that the term or the name Ozarks comes from a French phrase, Bois Ozark, which is spelled B-O-I-S-A-U-X-A-R-C. And literally this means something like bows made of wood, specifically the wood of the bois d'arc tree, or as the English call it, the bow d'arc. And the explanation for this is that when the first French settlers came into this area, which is now known as the Ozarks, they noticed that the Osage Indians, who were the principal Indian tribe in this territory, used a particular kind of bow made out of the wood from the bois d'arc tree, or the bow d'arc tree, as you will. And this was particularly strong. These bows were particularly strong, very, very difficult even for a lot of the Europeans to even use because it took such a strong amount of force to pull the bows back. Anyway, they applied this term, Bois Ozark, to more or less this whole region, and eventually, according to this theory, this term became shortened to Ozark, and eventually over a period of time anglicized into the present O-Z-A-R-K. That's one theory. Another theory is that the term Ozark comes ultimately from a geological theory that was around in the 18th century that was set forth primarily by a man named Abraham Gottlob Werner, who's a German geologist. And essentially his theory boiled down to the point that there were two basic types of rock found in the world. There were aqueous rock, which was formed by the actions of water, contained fossils. And there was azoic rock, which was formed by the action of fire, contained no kind of living organisms. Now, the early Europeans who came into this area, now known as the Ozarks, noticed that, at least through much of the area, there were these rocks which seemed to be what they considered azoic rock. So, because this region more or less formed an arc on a map, they call this the Azoic Arc region, or just the Azoic Arc. And eventually it was changed into the present O-Z-A-R-K, or Ozark. Like I said, those may sound a little bit wild, and nobody really knows where the name Ozark comes from, but those are two of the more popular theories that are advanced. And since we're dealing with Ozark folk songs, it might help a little bit to know what folklorists are talking about. We're going to talk about folk songs, ballads, and folklore in general. So before I talk just a few words about ballads and folk songs, I would like to at least offer sort of a tentative definition of what folklorists mean when they're speaking of folklore. And I guess if you ask any two folklorists, you might get a slightly different definition, just as if you ask any two historians to define history, or any two geographers to define geography, or any two biologists to define biology, you're probably going to get a slightly different answer. But I think that there are a lot of things that most folklorists would agree upon. And I think there are at least five features in any definition of folklore that any serious folklorist would advance. The first of these is that an item of folklore is something which is passed on orally, or perhaps a better word for it is informally. Quite often, in popular media, the songs of, say, someone such as Woody Guthrie, Bob Dylan, or some of Joan Baez, some of his historic, their songs are called folk songs, and by and large they're not, because they are not passed on in a kind of oral, informal manner. They're passed on mainly by print or by mass media. Now, this is not to say that folk singers, traditional singers, are not influenced at all by mass media, because they definitely are. But basically, the item of folklore is not something you don't go to school and study folk song and become a folk singer by studying folk song. It's something which is passed on basically in an oral, informal manner. The second criteria is that an item of folklore is something which is traditional. In other words, there are a lot of things which are passed on orally, or which are oral, but are not folklore. For example, in courtroom testimony would be oral, but certainly in most cases is not an item of folklore. So in order, it must be something which is passed on orally and becomes traditional in the sense that it becomes commonplace among a group of people that keep this item alive, be it a folk song, a ballad, proverb, legend, or whatever. Another criteria is that an item of folklore has to exist in more than one variant, more than one version. Once again, I go back to the idea that it's often put forth that the songs, say, of a Woody Guthrie are folk songs. And by and large, they're not, because they don't show any process of oral tradition. They exist only in the version in which it was originally written. A folk song, for example, has to exist in more than one version, or it really isn't a folk song. So you have to be oral, traditional. They exist in variants and versions. The item of folklore undergoes change over space and time. The fourth factor is that the item of folklore is anonymous. This doesn't mean that we don't know who wrote a specific song or a specific tale or a specific anything, but the item of folklore, the authorship, really is not important to the people who pass it on. Any song can become a folk song if it undergoes this process of oral tradition, and whether or not the song was written by, a William Shakespeare Hayes in the 19th century, or written by somebody in the 1940s, is not important to the people who pass it on. It has, in effect, become anonymous to these people who keep it alive. And then finally, the fifth criteria is that an item of folklore is formulaic. In other words, a lot of set phrases, cliches, if you will, are used, and these are basically mnemonic devices, ways of remembering the song. For example, there are phrases, say, in a ballad like Barbara Allen, a little motif about the flowers growing out of the grave of each of the lovers and twining a knot. This is one of the formulaic devices. These are just ways in which the folk singer can help to remember the item. So an item of folklore is oral, is traditional, undergoes change over space and time, becomes anonymous, and it is formulaic. Now, having said all that, there are basically two types of folk songs, and I know this terminology may be slightly confusing, because folk song is used as an overall generic term to mean both ballads and what folklorists call folk songs. And I won't go into any great detail about this, but I'll simply say that the folk song is distinguished from the ballad by the fact that the folk song does not tell a story. The ballad tells a story, a narrative of some sort. In some cases, it may be a very vague, continuous type of narrative, but there is a narrative there, whereas the folk song is simply a collection of lyrics which don't tell any connected narrative story. Now, in the Ozark Mountain region, there have been a number of people that have done collecting folk song, folk music, folk ballads, but probably none that have done more in this area than Vance Randolph. In fact, probably no one, probably no one has done more for Ozark folklore than Vance Randolph. And though he's always identified with the Ozarks, he was actually born slightly outside of the region in Pittsburgh, Kansas in 1892. He first came to the Ozarks in 1899 when he was 7 years old. His parents came down to Noel, Missouri, and he fell in love with the area right away. He did not actually move back to make it his permanent home until about 20 years later. He had fled graduate school, and actually, in one sense, I suppose you could say that Franz Boas, the famous anthropologist, German-American anthropologist who taught at Columbia University for many years, was somewhat responsible for his final move into this area, because Randolph wanted to do a PhD dissertation based on field work in the Ozarks, and Boas, of course, at that time was not interested in things that were not real exotic. He was mainly concerned with North American Indian tribes and suggested that Randolph instead do something on North Coast tribes, and this did not appeal to Randolph at all, and so he simply left graduate school and moved into the Ozarks. Beginning about 1920, he made his first collecting folk songs in this area. He was primarily influenced, at least at first, by two non-academics, and in fact, two not very good collectors. One, Carl Sandburg, who did a publication in the 1920s called American Songbag, later updated this in 1950. And the other one was Margaret Larkin, who did a small collection of cowboy songs called Singing Cowboy. They had known Randolph at the University of Kansas, had performed folk songs there in concerts for the students, and had talked to him about this and had gotten him enthused about it and encouraged him very much in going on to the Ozarks and doing his collecting. And of course, he went far beyond these two people. His collection is one of the most, if not the most important folk song collection in the United States. He continued collecting really up until about World War II, and at this time he was in the hospital in very critical condition, and it so happened that a man named Henry Bellin, who was at the University of Missouri, who himself did a major folk song collection, told the president of the State Historical Society of Missouri about Randolph's collection. And so he went to him and purchased the collection outright. They updated the annotations and published this in four volumes between 1946 and 1950. The collection is outstanding for a number of reasons, one of which is that unlike many early collectors, Randolph did not just print child ballads. Now, for those of you who do not know what child ballads are, this is a collection that was printed in 10 volumes, 1882 to 1898, by a Harvard professor named Francis Child, and he selected what he considered the oldest and best ballads, a total of 305 that he selected. And at this time, very little actual field recording has been done in this area. And so once he published his collection, it more or less implied that such songs were no longer sung in the United States or anywhere else for that matter. People started challenging that idea and went out and started collecting child ballads, versions and variants of these child ballads. Well, for a long time, that was the only thing that folk song collectors collected. So Randolph, instead, was pretty much ahead of his time in that he collected everything that was in the Folk Singer's repertoire. This included not only versions of the Four Marys, but versions of The Letter Etched in Black, an 1888 pop song, versions of Jimmy Rogers' songs. In fact, everything that was in the folk singer's repertoire, which gave you a much better idea, a more accurate picture of the aesthetics of the folk singer and their ideas about what a good song was, what songs were worth remembering and which weren't, and so forth. Now, I could go and talk about that quite a bit more, but I think we'd rather get into the actual singing. And so we'll begin with the first folk singer, Almeda Riddle, Greers Ferry, Arkansas. She was born there November 1898. And her father was a singing school teacher. She learned many songs from him and from other people in her neighborhood. Over the years, she kept a ballad book, that's B-A-L-L-E-T. A lot of folk singers do this. They note down the songs which they like, and just another way of making sure that they don't forget the words. In 1970, I believe it was, Roger Abrams, a folklorist within the University of Texas, made a selection of 52 songs from this ballad book and published them in a book called The Singer and Her Songs. And this was based on a series of tape interviews which he had made with Almeda over a number of years. It's perhaps the first widely distributed and certainly one of the most important folk autobiographies ever done in the United States. It's still in print. It was published by Louisiana State University Press. Almeda has been quite well known to not only people in the Ozarks for a long time, but people throughout the United States. She's appeared on a number of nationally distributed records. I guess the first one was a Vanguard record. She's appeared on the Rounder label, and most recently, an album of hers has been produced by a Minstrel record company. She's appeared also at a number of important national folk festivals, among them the Newport Folk Festival, which is perhaps the most publicized folk festival of the 1950s and 1960s, the Smithsonian Festival of American Folk Life, the National Folk Festival, and the Frontier Folk Life Festival. And I won't talk anymore. I'll simply introduce Almeda Riddle.
I was not born, neither was I reared in Greers Ferry. I was a companion. That's down below the Ozark. But never mind about that. We've heard enough about me and Vance. Both of that same. This is a child's ballad. And it's also in Vance's collection and in my collection. Last night there were, except there I went to sleep. But I wasn't afraid to trust the truth of the matter in Bill's hands, so I can see that he did. Last night there were four mayors. This night there'll only be three. There was Mary Eaton and Mary Seaton, Mary Carmichael. Last night I washed my queen's feet and I put braids in her hair. Now the ugliest thing it's ever gonna bring to me is a dimple sore. For words now in the kitchen and words all out in the hall. Oh, Mary Hamilton goes with child and by the highest steward of them all. Oh, he courted her in the kitchen, then he courted her down in the hall. And when he courted her in the low cellar, that was the time of it all. Mary Hamilton walks, oh, she's weak. I bear this to her child alone, that would be the death of me. Now her wee barn was still born, and she cast it into the sea. Lie there, you're the king's grandson, but you have no more need of me. Then down hath come her old queen, and the braids are yet in her hair. Oh, Mary Hamilton, where is your child? For I heard it crying full sore. There ne'er hath been a wee barn here, now anybody could see. Oh, it's just this pain in my poor heart, now the weeping ye heard, that was me. Well, put on your dress of red, my dear, or either black or brown, for before tomorrow sun shall set, what ride ye through Edinburgh town? Not put on a dress of red, nor yet a black or a brown, but array yourself in the purest white rose, yet the road her through Edinburgh town. And when she walked into Edinburgh court, now a heel came off on her shoe. 'Twas in the courts at Edinburgh that she was condemned to die. What's little did me poor old mother think that day she first prayed to me. Those distant lands I'd have to roam, or the death I'd have to die. Last night there were four Marys, this night there'll only be three. Mary Eaton and Mary Beaton, and Queen Mary, who's the head, you know me. Now that is, most of you know, is a Scottish song, and the old professor's smarter than the other. Collectors of folklore smarter than I am have looked, but they don't find in the beginning of who Mary Hamilton was. You just know that Lady Mary, Queen of Scots, beheaded her sometime in the 15th century, wasn't it? So that's all in Child's collection. And also, there's some versions of many different versions of the four Marys for Mary Hamilton. And I believe there's two or three in Vance's collection. This I learned from an old lady when I was 5 years old. Thank you. That's in Vance's collection, also in Child's collection. It's a Child's ballad. And of course, the difference between a traditional ballad and the song is written, the ballad is fluid and it just goes on and on, the other is frozen poetry. Now we do an English one. This is from England, and back in the early centuries, Lady Margaret was a lady in waiting on the Queen. Now, I haven't sang in a long time, I've got a little bit of cold. Now, what we gonna do, Lady Margaret, he said. Well, what can we do, said she. Far before tomorrow's sun shall set, Lord William's new bride I will see. Lord William's bride I'll see. Lady Margaret sat in her high hall tower, just a combing out her yellow hair. And along came William from the church nearby, he was leading his bride so fair, just leading his bride so fair. Now she threw down that dye, comb, and back she tossed her hair, and down she fell from the high hall window, never more was seen there. She never more was seen there. Now the day's all gone, and the night's come on, and the people all lie asleep. Lady Margaret rose from her coffin cold and stood a-weeping at William's bed feet. Stood weeping at William's bed feet. Well, it's how do you like that bed making? And it's how do you like your sheep? And it's how do you like that new made bride there in your arms asleep? She's lying there looking so sweet. Well, it's well that I like this bed making, and it's well do I like my sheep. But better would I like my old true love were she in my arms asleep, not weeping at my bed feet. What a dream, what an awful dream I've had. I fear it means no good. I dreamed my room was full of tears, and my bride all drowned in blood. My new bride drowned in blood. And then he called down his waiting men by one and two and three. Oh, ask me leave of my new made bride, for Lady Margaret I must see. Lady Margaret, I would see. Now if you go back to your Lady Margaret, then what's to become of me? Oh, I won't be gone but an hour or two until I return to thee, and I'll be true to thee. Oh, is she in her bower? Or is she in the hall? Or is she in her chambery out there in the main hall among the ladies all? That was a little bit wrong right there. No, she's not in her bowery room, and she's not in her hall. Lady Margaret lies in a coffin cold out there in the main hall, and her face is turned to the wall. Take off that coffin lid, turn back that sheet so fine. Oh, let me kiss Lady Margaret's lips. In life she has often kissed mine. In life she often kissed mine. Then the father took off the coffin lid, and the brother turned back the sheet. Three times he kissed the death cold lips, and he fell dead at her. Fell it at her feet. Lady Margaret, we buried in the old churchyard. Lord William, we buried a nigher. From Margaret's heart growing red, red rose. From William's grew a green briar. From William's grew a green briar. They grew to the top of the wall. When they could grow no higher, they looped and tied in a lover's knot. The rose still clung to her breast. I got that wrong. That was in Barbara Allen. Somebody put it in their years after Lady Margaret had it. They grew and they grew to the top of the wall. when they could grow no higher, they fell down to the cold, cold ground, but the rose still clung to the briar, and the rose embraced the briar. Now, there's a lot of folklore in that one, ancient folklore. This kiss of death, it was believed, you know, in the early centuries of England, that if anyone of the royals had touched the corpse, unless it was a relative, a blood relative, they immediately died. So, or William Ewing, he kissed her, he would die. And the father had to take off the coffin, and the brother turned back to the sheet. There's a lot of folklore in that one. Now, does someone have an old song they'd like to hear? If I know it, I'll do it. I don't know, but 400 or 500 will. So, it's too many of them. The house curtain. Here's my version of it. This I learned from my father in my early childhood. I'm sorry about my throat. I didn't bring this cold weather nor dust I ever went home. Well met my own true love. Oh, we're so well met, said he. Now I could have been married and to the king's daughter fair, and I would, but remember thee I would, but for love of thee. Well, if you could have married this king's daughter fair, then I think you're much to blame. I am well married to a house carpenter, and I think he's a fine young man. I proudly wear his name. Well, it's still purely this house carpenter, and come and go along with me. I take you where the grass is green, on the banks of the sweet Willie, and pleasure we will see. Then if I do leave my house carpenter, come and go along with thee, just what have you got to maintain me on, and keep me from poverty, to keep me from penury? Well, it's 7 ships on the ocean sailing, and the 8th just brought me in 110 brave sailor men. Will come when you command, will be under your command. Then she picked up her sweet little baby, and kisses she gave him 3. Said, stay here and hold your father, my son, him company, but try to remember me. Then she dressed herself in a scarlet dress. Oh, she's beautiful to be seen. She wrapped around herself a purple coat. Oh, she looked like a gypsy queen, and she stepped like a gypsy queen. Well, they'd been sailing for about 2 weeks, and I think it couldn't have been 3. This little lady, she began for to weep, and she wept bitterly, she wept most piously. And it's, why do you weep, my love, he said, for gold or silver or store? Or do you weep for the house carpenter Pond England shore, where you see him evermore. Oh, cursing be your gold and your silver and thrice cursed your store. I'm weeping for my own little baby that I left on the England shore when I see him anymore. Cheer up, dry up your tears, quoth he. Cheer up, saith he. For as I live, you never shall return. Well, they sailed on for about 3 weeks, and I know it was not four. The bottom of the ship sprang a leak and ended the ocean floor, and the flames began to roar. Oh, cursed be a sailor man, and thrice cursed men of the sea. You've taken me from my house, carpenter man. Now you're drowning me, or else you're burning me. And what are those hills, my love? She said, they look as white as snow. That is the hills of hell, my pet. I'm sorry, I'm off. What are those hills, my love? She said, they look as white as snow. That is the hills of heaven, my pet, where your little one will go, but heaven we will never know. And what are those other hills, she said, they look as black as night. That is the hills of hell, my pet, where you and I unite, where you and I will unite. Just a little more forgetting, and I'd have the baby in hell and the devil in hell. I have done that before.
I bet you sure took a memory. You remember them songs?
I don't know. It either took a fool or a good memory.
You bait in the wood?
Oh, bait in the woods. Now, this is one of the oldest songs that I've ever done research on in the English language. And that I can, that is, no, it isn't the oldest either. But it is one of the best known. And I've heard this in Canada, and sung in Canada, and collected through there and all over the United States. And just for a few words here and there, this is the only version I've ever heard of the bass words. Now don't you remember, 'twas a long time ago, there were two children, and their names I don't know. They were wandering along on a long summer day, got lost in the woods, I've heard people say. Now when it was night, so sad was their plight, the moon was not shining, the stars gave no light. They cried and sighed, they bitterly cried, and the poor little babes just lay down and died. Now when it was morning, a little robin so red, brought strawberries and all over them spread, and sang this song the whole summer long. Two babes in the woods, they had never done wrong. Now, Sheila McGregor from Sodom has one more verse to that. She wrote it out for me once when we were in Washington, but I never did remember it. I can't learn things and remember it now like I could from 5 years old. Now, somebody else knows a short one. I think we're going to have some music here. After a while, Bob Glyde, I think, and Lynn Orland's hiding in the bushes somewhere. They're supposed to come out. Does someone have a special favorite they want to do? What was it? Billiard off a big boy that wants that. La la la, tickle la la yo, and la la la, tickle la la yo, and tra la la, tickle la la yo, and la la la, tickle la la yo. Well, I'm gonna marry just who I please, la la la, tickle la la yo. Oh, I will if you'll marry me, and la la la, tickle la la yo. Think I'll marry little Johnny Green, la la la, tickle la la yo. That's boy I've ever seen, and la la la, chick-a-la-lee-o, la la la, chick-a-la-lee-o, and la la la, chick-a-la-lee-o, and la la la, chick-a-la-lee-o, and tra la la, chick-a-la-lee-o. There's dozens of verses to it. This little girl back there, would you come and help me do a China doll? Would you come and help me sing China doll for Froggy by the Court? Please, come here. Come on, I'm here all alone. Come on. Okay. Well, it's about time for me to stop, isn't it?
Couldn't you get China doll?
Barbara Allen and China doll. It's about time for both of us. Who asked for the China doll? Was it Ellen asked for Barbara Ellen?
Well, you do it for me.
Well, I do that for you in the top. Was you on the, was someone else on China doll? Well, Mama. Mama, I can't think of the tunes. Haven't sang it in a while. Mama, buy me China doll. Mama, buy me China doll. Mama, buy me a China doll. Do, Mama, do. Well, what could it take to buy it with? What could it take to buy it with? What could it take to buy it with? Oh, do, Mama, do. We could take Daddy's feather bed. Take Daddy's feather bed. Take Daddy's feather bed, do, Mommy, do. Then where would our Daddy sleep? Where would our Daddy sleep? Where would our Daddy sleep? Do, Mommy, do. Well, he could sleep in the puppy's bed. Sleep in the puppy's bed. Sleep in the puppy's bed, do, Mommy, do. Then where would your puppy sleep? Where would your puppy sleep? Where would your puppy sleep? Do, Mommy, do. He could sleep in the piggy's bed. Sleep in the piggy's bed. Sleep in the piggy's bed. Do, Mommy, do. Then where would the piggy sleep? Where would the piggy sleep? Where would the piggy sleep? Do, Mommy, do. He could sleep in the horse's bed. Sleep in the horse's bed. Sleep in the horse's bed. Do, Mommy, do. Then where would the horses sleep? Where would the horses sleep? Where would the horses sleep? Do, Mommy, do. He could graze out on their front lawn, graze out on their front lawn, graze out on their front lawn, do, Mommy, do. Then where would my children play? Where would my children play? Where would my children play? Do, Mommy, do. We could swing out there on the garden gate, swing out there on the garden gate, swing out on the garden gate, do, Mommy, do. Yes, and you'll get a spanking too. Yes, and you'll get a spanking too. Yes, and you'll get a spanking too. Do, mama, do. Bob, you better get on up here. I'm not going out.
Should have said before we got started on the singing that folk singers have a particular style that's nothing like what is often called folk singing on the radio. Folk singers, put it briefly, I guess, use what is a totally objective style of singing. In other words, unlike someone, say, like Joan Baez or any so-called folk singer that you may hear on radio or TV, they do not call attention to the importance of the song by using extremes of musical dynamics. In other words, when there's an important point in the song, they don't emphasize it by suddenly getting much louder or much softer. They basically maintain the same loudness throughout, the same pitch, the same tempo throughout. Of course, the oldest instrument in the world is the human voice, and nowadays a lot of people think of, when they think of Southern Mountain folk singing in particular, think that the guitar is the instrument that goes with it, but actually the guitar is relatively late arrival on the scene. It really did not become too important until the 20th century. An instrument which came to this country and made its way slowly over a period of centuries from Spain, and as I said, became popular in this country, well, really in the late 19th century, a number of guitar clubs in bigger cities in the United States helped popularize the instrument, and really good instrument for recording. It was relatively easy to play. And the guitar introduced a number of changes in the music. I guess the most important is that, unlike in the past when singers sang or musicians played, they played melody notes note for note. With a guitar, they did not have to do this. Guitar really introduced to Southern folk music the idea of chords and chord progression, so that an accompaniment for a tune could be made up of chord progressions rather than playing each individual melody note as has been done in the past. And of course, this meant that a lot of the older ballads really couldn't be accompanied by the guitar, because a lot of the older ballads, particularly like some of the child ballads that Almeda did, were modal. And the guitar was not well suited for this type of song. It was basically a song that was compressed into the Western major minor system rather than the older modal system. A lot of the singers who used the guitar, of course, had a large repertoire of 19th century sentimental songs. And that's certainly the case with Bob Blair. He was born in 1932 in Pleasant Grove, Arkansas. He learned a lot of songs from his father, Earl Blair, who was also a great old-time fiddler, died about 7 or 8 years ago. And I'm not going to talk anymore. I'm going to turn it over to Bob, and Earl can do whatever he wants to do here.
I'll find something. I can go send most of the songs I learned primarily in the family. Normally I never pay too much attention to who wrote the songs or who sung them. If I liked one, I just learned it and sung it. And I'm not sure, there's a song that Dad used to like and always liked real well. It's called Nola Shannon. and I think it was written about 18, or maybe copyright 1876. Bill, do you know? Is that right? And it's kind of a short song, so I'll travel a little bit. I may make too much noise. If I make too much noise with a stick, tell me, I'll turn it down. In the shady dell, down by a flowing stream, well, sweet Nola Shannon, she is nature's queen. All the boys and girls around the neighborhood fall in love with Nola just because she's good. Sweet Nola Shannon, Nola Shannon adore. Each time I see her, I love her more. Bright as the sunshine, she is the girl I prefer. She loves me truly, and I do love her. Every Sunday eve, at the hour of eight, Nola comes to greet me at the garden gate. Arm in arm we stroll through the shady dell. Twinkling stars may watch us kiss, but never. Sweet Nola Shannon, Nola Shannon adore. Each time I see her, I love her more. Bright as the sunshine, she's the girl I prefer. She loves me truly, and I do.
I get up before an audience, it always makes me nervous and I forget words, but that is a short song. Might as well do a funny one, I guess. A little bit funny sometimes. This is I Got Mine and He Got Mine. Most of you have heard it.
I went out to a big rat game, was against my will. I bet all my money except one greenback dollar bill. Put $100 on the table and the feelings they were high. Just then a cop came through the door and I got mine. I got mine, boy, I got mine. I grabbed that $100 and for the window I declined. For a while was wearing good clothes, living on chicken and wine. I was a leader in society when I got mine. Well, I went into the big cafe, I went in there to dine. I only had 15 cents, I was full of good white wine. I ate everything on the table, I was feeling mighty fine. And I handed over that 15 cents and I got mine. I got mine, boys, I got mine. They used me for a football, that kicking they was fine. They kicked me through the window, I got there just in time. A policeman took me to the judge and I got mine. Well, I went to get some chicken, the night was very fine. I found them roosting very high and for them I declined. A bulldog came prowling round, got there just in time. He got me by the seat of the pants and he got mine. He got mine, boys, he got mine. The rascal took my riches, he did it very fine. I'm at home in a barrel, I got there just in time. I used some Dr. Brown Sapper, he got mine.
Is there anything in particular you want me to do?
Yeah, but I can't think of the name.
Oh, well, I thought it would be more.
I can't
recall.
Do that song about the bird.
The bee?
Bird.
Birds.
Oh, this is the old song Dad used to do. Sort of a old, maybe I can remember. Oh, I wish I was a little bird. I'd fly to the top of the tree. I'd fly and sing a sad little song I can't stay here by myself. Oh, I can't stay here by myself. I can't stay here by myself. I'd fly and sing a sad little song I can't stay here by myself. Once I had plenty money, my friends all around the stand. Now my pockets are empty and I have not a single friend to land. Farewell, farewell, corn whiskey, farewell, peach brandy too. You robbed my pockets of silver and I have no use for you. Oh, I wish I was a little fish, I'd swim to the bottom of the sea. I'd swim and sing a sad little song, can't stay here by myself. Oh, I can't stay here by myself, I can't stay here by myself. I'd swim and sing a sad little song, can't stay here by myself. Kind of short, huh? I don't know what the name of this is. It's I think we used to call it a Little Mud Cabin way down in Tennessee.
Yeah, that's what I wanted you to sing.
A honey, a more than a one day, is that it? What's the title, Bill?
I don't know.
Honey, are you mad at your man? Honey, do you love your man?
Yeah, do you love him?
In a little mud cabin way down in Tennessee, where the morning glories creep around the door, there lives a prettiest little brown-eyed girl waiting there for me. She has been my lady friend for 1 year or more. Honey, more than one day, cast those big eyes upon me. Lend me your little brown hand. We can live on hugs and kisses if you'll only be my missus. And it's honey, do you love your man? Been saving up my money, gonna marry her someday. I don't even fool with a dime. Every penny that I get, I'm gonna give it to her. I couldn't love her anymore, and I'm gonna make her mine. Honey, more than one day, cast those big eyes upon me. Lend me your little... When the southern sun was sinking, I used to hold her little hand. Honey, more than one day, you cast those big eyes upon me. Bend me your little brown hand. We can live on hugs and kisses if you'll only be my missus. And it's honey, do you love your man? Songs seem to have taken on, for some reason or another, maybe it's the amount of time that's required by people recording or playing. Now it seems to have been shortened a great deal. You only get portions of the song anymore. You hear on most tapes and so forth, you don't hear all the verses to the song. Many of the older songs were about, I guess, anywhere from about 8 to 20 verses long. Is that not out of the... And I never could remember over 2 or 3 anyway, so it was better for me. I'll do a little. If I can remember, Jackie Joe.
2 years ago when Jack and Joe set sail across the foam, each vowed a fortune he would make before returning home. In one short year, Jack and himself set sail for home that day. And as the pals shook hands to part, her Joe could only say, give my love to Nellie Jack and kiss her once for me. The sweetest girl in all the world, I know you'll say it is she. Treat her kindly, Jack, old boy, and tell her I am well. His parting words were, don't forget to give my love to Nell. 2 years had passed when Joe at last had gained his wealth for life. He set sail across the sea to make sweet Nell his wife. But on his way he heard them say that Jack and Nell had fled. He sobs, he frets, he now regrets that he had ever said, give my love to Nellie Jack and kiss her once for me. The sweetest girl in all the world, I know you'll say it to me. Treat her kindly, Jack, old boy, and tell her I am well. His parting words were, don't forget to give my love to Nell. Up on the street they chanced to meet, Joe said, you self-retell. The very next girl I learned to love, I'll kiss her for myself. But all is fair in love, they say, and since you've gone and wed, I'll not be angry with you, Jack, so once again he said, give my love to Nellie Jack and kiss her once for me. The sweetest girl in all the world, I know you'll say it is she. Treat her kindly, Jack, old boy, and tell her I am well. His parting words were, don't forget to give my love to Nell.
Do Bonnie Lassie with your back a little. You got enough wind, Lance.
This is hard for me to sing, so bear with me. Drums in my heart are drumming, I hear the bagpipes humming, my Bonnie Lassie's coming over the sea. She left her native highland to come and live in my land. She'll love the folks who smile and say, how do you? I am a meter on the shore, playing the pipe for her, dressed in a kilt and a tiny shiner too. Drums in my heart are drumming, I hear the bagpipes humming, my Bonnie Lass is coming, coming to me. Sad are the lads leaving, many a sigh they're heaving, even the heathers are grieving, sighing a do. She left her native highland to come and live in my land. She'll love the folks who smile and say, howdy do. I don't need her on the shore, playing the pipe for her, dressed in a kilt and a tan shiner too. Drums in my heart are drumming, I hear the bagpipes humming, my Bonnie Lass is coming, coming to me. One song in particular I've always liked, an older version of that, I think, that's our latest set of words, for Scotland the Brave. Let me look for my little paper here and see what I have down there about the...
Goodbye,
mate. Well, I may skip a verse or two on this, but this is also a song I like, so... This is a sad one. I like sad songs. Near a cottage in the twilight stood a soldier and a maid. Solemn words were being spoken for his company. Down her cheek the teardrops flowing, tearfully she bids him stay. Sad but firmly comes an answer, Maggie dear, I'm called away. Next the sound of mortal footsteps leading by her cottage door, and a soldier smiling gravely is her she'll see no more. See him wave his hand at parting, hear him sigh her sigh and softly say, dry your tears, my little darling, Maggie dear, I'm called away. Goodbye, Maggie, goodbye, darling, though I'll think of you each day. It's decreed that I must leave you, Maggie dear, I'm called away. There has been a fearful conflict. Victory has been nobly won. And the youth, oh soldier dying, yeah, his life has well begun. Comrades, he is feebly saying, I shall never live till day. If you are spared to see my darling, tell her I was called away. Goodbye, Maggie, goodbye, darling, though I'll think of you each day. It decreed that I must leave you, Maggie dear, I'm called away. All right. Thank you. I hope I did one if you haven't heard.
In case you're wondering how these people were selected, I tried to get singers, and I succeeded in getting singers that I knew Vance personally was fond of. He was aware of their singing and had heard them many times in the past and liked them. The next person, when I first went up to visit Vance in 1976, shortly after I came to the Folk Center, he thought that I was Glenn Orland. And I told him, I called his wife and told him I was coming up, and I guess he didn't know my name. He was from Mountain View, and he had read Hellbound Train and really liked it. he thought it was Glenn that was coming up, so he was disappointed that it was me. Glenn is perhaps the best known singer of traditional cowboy songs in the country. He was actually born in Minneapolis, Minnesota, 1926. His parents were Swedish immigrants, and he learned songs and guitar from his family. And when he was 14, around the time of World War II, they moved to California, and a couple of years later, he started out being a cowboy in Nevada. For a number of years, up until I think 1965, he was on the rodeo circuit. In 1965, he retired from that. In 1954, he had moved here from California, and he still runs a ranch about 3 miles out of town here. His book, The Hellbound Train, which is a selection of 100 songs, cowboy songs, was published in 1973 by the University of Illinois Press. He's appeared on a number of records. He has not previously, even though he's well known as a teller of tall tales, has not had any of these recorded until just recently. And he's going to be on an album that we're currently working on of traditional Ozark tale tellers and singers. He's going to be telling some of his tall tales. And without any further ado, I'd like to turn it over to Glenn Orr.
First time I run across Vance Randolph's books, I was browsing around the library in Batesville. And I'm one of the world's greatest browsers. So anybody that's got a private library and I've been to their house will know I just kind of go through stuff like a hurricane. And it said Ozark Folk Songs, and I'd just been here a few years and I wondered what that was. And I looked in there and by golly, just lots and lots of songs I'd known and heard all over the country. And I didn't realize up until that moment that most of the old cowboy songs I knew and other odds and ends were folk songs. I thought folk songs, it had to be Burl Ives singing it, or that wasn't it. But I gleaned a few out of the books, and sometimes I don't really take to a song unless I hear somebody else sing it. Here's one that a friend of mine picked up on out of there. It's called The Chickens Grow Tall in Arkansas. And then I went ahead and buckled down to learn the song. It was a very religious girl that got me singing this song. Say no more about that. Oh, the chickens grow tall in Arkansas. The chickens grow tall in Arkansas. Oh, the chickens, they grow tall, and the meat tastes just like gall. And they eat them guts and all in Arkansas. Oh, they chewed her back earth in Arkansas. They chewed her back earth in Arkansas. They chewed her back earth in, and it runs down on their chin. Then they lick it up again in Arkansas. Oh, they say the drink's a sin in Arkansas. They say the drink's a sin in Arkansas. This is a dry county, by the way. Oh, they say the drink's a sin, so they guzzle all they can. Then they throw it up again in Arkansas. Oh, the people never win in Arkansas. people never wed in Arkansas. The people never wed, or so I've heard it said. They just tumble into bed in Arkansas. This is where the new morality was invented. Oh, the buzzards fly high in Arkansas. The buzzards fly high in Arkansas. Oh, the buzzards, they fly high and they fly right in your eyes. It's lucky cows don't fly in Arkansas. He's got a section on cowboy songs. There's always been some of them, I guess, in tradition in the Ozarks. So I read in there. And investigating around here a little bit, I found that among most families, there's some real old, kind of what seemed to me like real antique cowboy songs. You didn't even hear them out west much anymore. And they tended to be kind of sentimental kind of songs, cowboy songs. But here's one that's still, when I was a kid, I worked in Arizona a lot. Here's one of the songs everybody there knew about Billy Venero. Billy Venero heard them say in an Arizona town one day, a band of Apache Indians was on the trail of death. He heard tales of murder done, free men killed at Rocky Run. They're in danger at the cow ranch, cried Venero under his breath. Cow ranch 40 miles away, in a little place that lay in a deep and shady valley in the mighty wilderness. Half a score of homes were there, in one a maiden fair held the heart of Billy Venero, Miss Venero's little bed. Not a moment he delayed when his brave resolve was made. Why, man, his comrades told him when they heard his daring plan. You are riding straight to death, but he answered, save your breath. I may never reach the cow ranch, but I'll do the best I can. Low and lower sank the sun, he drew rein at Rocky Run. Here three men to death, Machapo, and he stroked his glossy mane. Social oaths would go to warn near the coming of the morn. If we fail, God help my Bessie, and he started on again. Sharp and clear a rifle shot woke the echoes of the spot. I am wounded, cried Venero, as he swayed from side to side. While there's life, there's always hope. Slowly onward I shall lope. If I never reach the cow ranch, Bessie Lee will know I tried. I will save her, yet he cried. Bessie Lee will know I tried. For her sake he halted in the shadow of a hill. Then with trembling hands he took from his shaps a little book, tore a blank leaf from its pages, said, this will be my will. From a limb a twig he broke, and he dipped his pen of old in the warm blood flowing from a wound above his heart. Around he wrote before too late, Apache warriors lying in wait. Goodbye, God bless you, darling, he felt the cold tears start. Then he made the message fast, love's first message ain't its last. To the saddle horn he tied it, and his lips was white with pain. Take this message, if not me, straight to little Bessie Lee. He tied himself to the saddle and he started on again. Just at dusk a horse of brown, wet with sweat, came panting down. The little lane to the cow ranch, and he stopped at Bessie's. But the rider was asleep, his slumber was so deep, little Bess could never wake him, though she tried forevermore. You have heard the story told by the young and by the old. Down yonder at the cow ranch, the night the Apaches came. Of the sharp and bloody fight, how the chief fell in the night, and the panic-stricken warriors when they heard an arrow's name. Now the heaven and earth between keeps a little flower so green. Bessie Lee had planted ere they laid her by his side. I guess that's a true story, because Billy Venero is buried in several places in Arizona. One of the things Bill in his opening remarks says that, mentioned that folk singers, I'm using his words now, learn their stuff informally, you know. They don't go to school and learn to be folk singers. They just pick up on a bunch of stuff, and someday somebody figures out what it is, you know. And I always liked funny songs better than anything else. And here's one I like to sing once in a while. Before I start, I'd kind of like to know if any of you married men wish you was single, stand up so I'll know who I'm singing for. Well, ain't nobody, that's nice.
You didn't really expect anybody to stand up your wife, did you?
I got one time. I was over here in the big auditorium last year, and a little bitty feller all trembling and scared got up. He stood up for about a moment, and somebody slapped him down right away. Well, he made a stab at it anyway. Probably everybody here knows at least the chorus of this thing. Usually it messes me up if somebody sings along, but go ahead. Oh, I wish I was single again. I wish I was single again. 'Cause when I was single, my pockets did jingle, and I wish I was single again. I married me a wife, oh then, oh then. I married me a wife, oh then. I married me a wife and she's ruined my life, and I wish I was single again. Oh, I wish I was single again. I wish I was single again. 'Cause when I was single, my pockets did jingle, and I wish I was single again. Biffed me, she banged to hang me, and I wish I was single again. She went for the rope, oh then, oh then. She went for the rope, oh then. She went for the rope, when she got there, 'twas broke, and I wish I was single again. My wife, she died, oh then, oh then. My wife, she died, oh then. My wife, she died, and I laughed till I cried to think I was single again. I went to the funeral, oh then, oh then. I went to the funeral, oh then. Funeral and I danced Yankee Doodle to think I was single again. I married me another, oh then, oh then. I married me another, oh then. I married me another, the devil's grandmother, and I wish I was single again. Oh, I wish I was single again, again. I wish I was single again. 'Cause when I was single, my pockets did tingle, and I wish I was single again.
Permissible, Bill? Sure. Uh-huh. Bill.
Boy. Can you still sing Hard Traveling?
No.
You're not going to do that.
I've got a tape up to do it. Oh, have you? I ain't sung it since then. That's been about 15 years.
Have you really forgotten it?
Yeah, I sure have. Got kind of a selective memory, too. Yeah. Let's see. Now, why Gordon wants to hear Barnacle Bill, don't panic. Now, I know two versions of Barnacle Bill. I don't want him to shut the center down because I get to do a little work here once in a while. I'll try to stay with the one that's permissible. It's hard to sing because you got to sing in two voices. If I don't get started on the right key, I'll have to quit and start again someplace else. And I never remember where I put anything. That ought to get it. Well, here I am on land again, said Barnacle Bill the sailor. I drank 1,000 quarts of gin, said Barnacle Bill the sailor. I had me a girl went here before, I swore I'd never see no more, but here I am at her front door, said Barnacle Bill the sailor. Like a bloody typhoon, said Barnacle Bill the sailor.
I'll come down and let you in.
Well, heave ho and hurry up, said Barnacle Bill the Sailor. Well, heave ho and hurry up, said Barnacle Bill the Sailor.
Oh, did you see any whales? Oh, did you see any whales? Oh, did you whales, cried the fair young maiden.
Well, I must have seen a thousand whales, said Barnacle Bill the Sailor. I grabbed them by their big toenails, said Barnacle Bill the Sailor. I tied them together two by two, and I drug them down to Timbuktu, and I swapped them off for a kangaroo, said Barnacle Bill the Sailor. There's more, but I think I better cut it off here because I'm getting my verses from here on kind of mixed up. I had a friend once years ago went plumb nuts. And I hate to say it, but he did. And I taught him the other version of that. And he thought it was great fun to walk in anywhere singing it. Well, he got about 1,000 knots pounded on the side of his head. I'm going to tell you a little story about what I seen this guy do one time. Since I guess that's part of what we do here too, is tell about stuff. But this guy that went ape, he wasn't Tarzan, he was the first one that went ape. This guy was the second. Well, me and him was whooping it up one night in a little place in the Red River Valley of the North called Bijou. And they had a little bar there, and we really got to hooping it up, and we had about 12 miles out in the prairie to go to get home. We decided we couldn't drive that far without getting something to eat and kind of get feeling a little more like driving and everything. So there was an all-night cafe in this little place, about 300 people. We stopped in there to get something to eat, to sober up so we could drive. And I'd spent so many years on the cheeseburger circuit, I knew I could handle that, so I got a cheeseburger and a cup of coffee, and he ordered a round steak smothered in gravy and onion. And I didn't know why he did. I didn't think he could handle it. But I was wrong. He cuts out the bone and throws it over his shoulder and grabbed that steak and held it right up to his face. And I seen his jaw come through the bottom of the steak. And he ate the whole thing that way. And I'm sitting right across from him trying to eat a cheeseburger, and I sobered up watching him. And he got gravy and onions all over his face, all over his clothes. Finally, all he had left was a little scrap of fat around the edges. I guess he didn't like fat because he just throwed it down. And I'm telling you, I was just about, the word they use now would be freaked out. But the word I used then was sick. But anyway, we went to pay. I noticed I got to looking around, and everybody else in the place was way back in the corner. And I went back there to try to pay them for the grub, and we couldn't even pay them. They was so scared they just backed up in the corner and kind of ran from us. I'll get back to something more suitable maybe here. I mentioned that a lot of the old songs, cowboy songs here, tend to be kind of sentimental songs that most anybody would understand all right. But a lot of the songs I picked up on as a kid, cowboying in Nevada and Arizona and different places, what I call hardcore cowboy songs, because nobody else would sing them, you know.
Can you sing the old version of the Streets of Laredo?
I know a little bit of it. I was kind of leading up to Windy Bill, but okay. Here's some real cowboy terms in this song. One time I heard Ike Rude, who is world champion steer roper, years and years ago recite this thing as a poem. Oh, Windy Bill was a Texas boy and he could rope, you bet. He swore the steer he couldn't tie he hadn't met as yet. The boys knew of an old black steer that ran down in the draw at the bottom of the Malpais and the sorter bad outlaw. Now many a boy had tried this steer, but he got away for fair. We bet old Bill at 2-1, he couldn't quite set there. He saddled up his old gray horse, his back and withers raw. He started after the old black steer that ran down in the draw. With his Sam Stack tree and his new McGay and his spurs and chaps to boot, his rope tied to the saddle horn, he tackled that old brute. But when he caught the old black steer, the cinches broke like straw, and his Sam Stack tree and his new McGay went drifting down the draw. Now Bill lit in a flint rock pile, his face and his head was scratched. We got him up and dusted him off and sorter got him patched. He just stood there a cussin' maddest man you ever saw, while his Sam Stack tree and his new McGay went driftin' down the draw. There's a moral to my story, boys, as you can plainly see. Don't never tie your catch rope to your saddle tree. But take your dally welters to the California law, and your Sam Stack tree and your new McGay won't go drifting down the draw. Idea how the old tune went. They didn't used to sing that Burl Ives tune to it. It was a different tune, just like my home's in Montana. As he walked out in the streets of Laredo, as he walked out in Laredo one day, I spied a young cowboy all wrapped in white linen, all wrapped in white linen, as cold as the clay. That's not maybe as pretty a tune. Well, the one that everybody calls Streets of Laredo now, I believe, originated with Burl Ives. Same song.
It's sung to the same tune as the trooper cut down in his prime as an important tree.
But I don't like songs that got confusions of tunes and stuff. I kind of got almost cut down in my prime, too, for singing the wrong songs. Somebody asked me if I ever sung any child ballads, and I said, no, most of my songs is for grown-ups. But there's one that I knew since I was a kid. It was Barbara Allen, and I promise I'll never sing it again. A friend of mine out in California, we both kind of grew up in the same cowboy bar for several years. They had twins, or his wife did, and he said, let's go celebrate. Well, they kept a guitar and a microphone in this place, although they never hired anybody, but among that crowd, often someone would get the urge to get up and sing. So I got up and I sang Barbara Allen. And under the circumstances, I was singing extra slow that day. And I knew everybody in the place but four strangers sitting at a table. When I got done, finally, that's about 100 verses, they all got up and walked over to me. And one of them, their spokesman, looks me right in the eye and he said, if you don't sing better than that, we're going to kill you. My friends heard it, you know, and I kind of looked desperately over there, and they grabbed them guys and thumped them a little and threw them out. But I quit singing for years and years and years until I kind of got into this folk song. I just wouldn't sing nothing or anybody could hear me. Here's one some of you might remember. I bet you anything Almeda remembers it. See.
Probably not if Glenn Orman sings it. She wouldn't say, she wouldn't claim she did if she did.
We've been arguing back and forth like this for about 15 years. She always asked me to sing something I've never sung one yet. She's asked me to sing or done anything.
I'm trying to let on like he's younger than what he is. It's been 20 years since I first sung
in the Lord. I was just a little bitty old feller then, wasn't I?
Okay, that's
all
right. Well, I'm okay.
She sat down beside, oops, that's too high. She sat down beside him and played her guitar under the star. Played her guitar, well, she sat beside him, played her guitar under the star. Well, he sat beside her and he smoked his cigar under the star. Smoked his cigar. He sat beside her and he smoked his cigar under the stars. He told her he loved her, but oh, how he lied. Oh, how he lied. Oh, how he lied. He told her he loved her, but oh, how he lied. Oh, how he lied. Then she took consumption and she up and died. She up and died. She up and died. Then she took consumption and she up and died. She up and died. He went to the funeral, but just for the ride, just for the ride, just for the ride. He went to the funeral, but just for the ride, just for the ride. Then he took consumption and he up and died, he up and died. He up and died, then he took consumption, and he up and died, he up and died. Then she went to heaven and flip-flop she fly, flip-flop she fly, flip-flop she fly. Then she went to heaven and flip-flop she fly, flip flop, she flies. Then he went to Hades and sizzle and fry, sizzle and fry, sizzle and fried. He went to Hades and sizzle and fry, sizzle and fry.
We're not leaving because we're just satisfied
you
sing. We just
got
to go.
Okay. When you got to go, you got to go. I know. Go on.
I have one that goes, I ride an old train, so I leave an old train.
Let's see. Yeah, I know a couple, two or three songs that's got words like that. And there is another case where I've heard several different tunes to songs. And I might not sing the tune you expect, but the... Is I ride an old paint and I leave an old dam. Is that the one?
Yeah,
or?
I walked my tunnel.
Yeah, well, yeah. I ride an old paint and I lead an old land. I'm off to Montana to throw the hooly hand. They feed in the coolies, they water in the draw. Their tails are all matted, their backs are all raw. Ride around little Logies, oh, ride around slow. For the fiery and the snuffy are raring to go. Bill Jones had two daughters, Bill Jones had a son. One went to Denver and the other went wrong. His wife, she died in a pilgrim fight. But still he keeps singing from morning till night. Ride around, little Logies, oh, ride around slow, for the fiery and snuffy are raring to go. See, the other one was going. Goodbye, old paint, I'm a leaving shy. Old Payne's a good pony, he paces when he can. Goodbye, old Payne, I'm a leaving Cheyenne. Leaving Cheyenne, I'm off to Montana. Goodbye, old Payne, I'm a leaving. I guess I'll wind her up here with one more song. It's about the cowboy wanders into a high-tone dance. Well, that's the name of the song, High-Tone Dance. Try to see. So I can play in more than one key than A, anyway. Well, you can't expect a cowboy to agitate his shanks in etiquette-ish manner in aristocratic ranks, when he's always been accustomed to shake a heel and toe at the rattling rancher's dances where much etiquette don't go. You can bet I said I'm laughing in an astonished sort of way, a giving of their squinters an excited sort of play. When I happened into Denver and was asked to take a prance in the smooth and easy measures of a high-tone dance. When I got amongst the ladies in their frocks of fleecy white and the dudes togged out in wrappings, simply out of sight. Tell you what, I was embarrassed and somehow I couldn't keep feeling like a burro in a flock of pretty sheep. Every step I took was awkward and I blushed a flaming red like the principal decoration on a turkey gobbler's head. And the lady said it was seldom that they ever got a chance to see an old-time puncher at a high-tone dance. Well, I cut me out a heifer from that flock of pretty girls. I yanked her to the center to dance them dreamy whirls. She laid her head upon my bosom in a loving sort of way. We drifted into heaven as the band began to play. I could feel my neck a-burning from her nose's breathing heat as she do-si-do'd around me half the time upon my feet. and she gazed up in my blinkers with a soul-dissolving glance quite conducive to the pleasures of a high-toned dance. Every nerve just got to tingling to that music of delight, and I hugged that little sage-hen uncomfortably tight. But she never made a beller, and the glances of her eyes seemed to thank me for the pleasure of a genuine surprise. Oh, she cuddled up against me in a loving sort of way. I hugged her all the tighter for her trust to find play. Tell you what, the joys of heaven need a cussed circumstance to the hugomania pleasures of a high-toned dance. When they struck that old cotillion on the music bill of fare, every bit of devil in me seemed to fetch out on the tear. I let out a cowboy war whoop and I started into rag, till the rafters started shaking and the floor began to sag. Then my partner, she got seasick and she staggered for a seat. I balanced to the next one, but she dodged me slick and neat. Tell you what, I took the creases from their go-to-meeting pants when I put the cowboy trimmings on that high-toned dance.
Once again, let me remind you, please fill out those green forms and turn them in either over here or at the table outside. If you're interested in seeing the new edition of Ozark Folk Songs, it's back on the outside table along with some other folk music books that are published by the University of Missouri Press and Pettus Devis from the University of Missouri Press here. So if you have any questions about any of the books, please ask her. Pat, would you stand there so people know? And I have nothing further to add. Almeda has some of her records over here if you're interested in buying these. So I thank you all for coming today.